I think we'll get started. If people could take their seats, please. Welcome, everyone. I'm Xerxes Spencer, Manager of Fellowship Programs here at the National Endowment for Democracy. On behalf of NED's International Forum for Democratic Studies, I'm delighted to welcome everyone to today's presentation, Ebola's Impact on Women and Children in Sierra Leone, Why Accountability Matters, featuring Reagan Fussell Democracy Fellow Ela Maya Rogers, the spelling of her name is a little deceptive, with comments by Kamisa Kamara, Senior Program Officer for Central and West Africa here at the NED. Funded by the US Congress, the Reagan Fussell Democracy Fellows Program hosts some of the world's most dedicated democracy activists, scholars, and journalists to conduct independent research and pursue projects here at the NED. Now in our 13th year, the program has hosted more than 200 fellows from over 80 countries since 2001. Within this remarkable group, our speaker today stands out for her unwavering commitment to women's rights, children's rights, and accountability in Sierra Leone. In her presentation, Ela will evaluate the impact of the Ebola outbreak on women and children in Sierra Leone, and how corruption has hampered development efforts, including the improvement of healthcare services. The Ebola outbreak has exposed an ineffective healthcare system, poor governance, and deficient institutional capacity in the three most affected countries of West Africa, Guinea, Liberia, and Sierra Leone. In Sierra Leone, women and children account for nearly 70% of victims. Healthcare workers are predominantly female, and because of the massive diversion of funds to combat the epidemic, maternal and child care has declined, causing an increase in maternal and infant mortality. The international community has launched a coordinated response through donations, medical supplies, and military aid, but such efforts address the symptoms, not the root causes. The Ebola outbreak highlights the lack of government accountability in Sierra Leone, including a non-transparent budget and minimum allocation of funds to improving healthcare. Ela will offer a set of recommendations for the citizens and government of Sierra Leone, as well as the Sierra Leonean diaspora and international community on how best to tackle the challenges ahead. Ela is a leading human rights lawyer whose journey towards human rights advocacy started from an early age. I want to read an excerpt from her fellowship application, which offers a fascinating window into her human rights journey. And I quote, "I come from a polygamous home with more than 50 siblings and 10 stepmothers. By the age of 15, I had dropped out of school and witnessed my mother being subject to spousal abuse. For me, human rights is a personal journey. It is not only a journey into my personal circumstances, but also a story of all the women in the developing world with untapped potential. I went to law school hoping to make it out of poverty. In 2005, my life changed forever while volunteering for a human rights organization, Advocate. While visiting and documenting cases of wrongfully convicted women serving on death row, I saw firsthand what a broken legal system can amount to if one is an illiterate woman in a developing country. As these women awaited their fate, many were raped behind bars. Since that experience, I no longer wanted to be just a lawyer. I decided to be a human rights lawyer, and maybe a women's rights lawyer, if there ever was such a thing." End quote. Well, Ela has gone on to realize her dreams, having become an outspoken women's rights advocate who has worked for several human organizations in Sierra Leone, including Advocate and others. Between 2007 and 2009, she was president of Furabe College's Human Rights Clinic, where she pushed for the enactment of legislation protecting women and children. In 2011, she won a scholarship to study human rights law at Harvard University and was selected to deliver the class commencement address in 2012. During her fellowship at NED, she's exploring how online technologies can help citizens fight corruption in Sierra Leone. Kamisa Kamara is the Senior Program Officer Africa here at NED, where she oversees grant-making programs in both sub-regions. She previously worked for IFAS, managing electoral assistance projects in sub-Saharan Africa and the Caribbean. We'll now turn the floor over to Ila, who will speak for about 25 minutes, followed by Kamisa, who will speak for about 10. For those of you on Twitter, you can follow the presentation and contribute to the conversation by using the hashtag NEDEvents or by following the forum at ThinkDemocracy and the endowment at NEDemocracy. If you haven't already done so, please take a moment to silence your cell phones. Finally, let me take an opportunity to thank the many staff involved in preparing for this event, most especially Ayhan Uchok. Thank you very much. Ila.
Thank you very much, Zaxis, for that kind introduction. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you very, very much for coming. You know, in Sierra Leone, the war has been compared to Ebola. Of course, we had a 10-year brutal civil conflict before Ebola. But increasingly, many people are saying that the war that left thousands of people dead is much more better than this vicious disease. Because with a war, you can actually see and preempt your enemy, and not so with Ebola. I flew from Cape Town to Washington in late September to start this five-month fellowship with NED. And as often as I do with long transatlantic flights, I make friends with fellow passengers. Sometimes this is very necessary, not only because of the long journey or the long flight, but at some point you may actually want the guy seated next to you to stand up so you can use the restroom. So on this particular trip, we spoke about the weather, we spoke about family, we spoke about movies, but then with 10 hours to go, like many other Sierra Leoneans these days who travel, I started dreading that big question. Where are you from? Eventually, I told my new friend that I am from Sierra Leone, and I can only imagine what went through her mind, perhaps quietly thinking that she may be seated next to a potentially infected Ebola person. But thankfully, whatever was in her thoughts, her face did not betray. But it reminded me what a friend of mine once told me in Creole. He said, "Ila, gentryman, not de na poor man country." Meaning, in the land of the poor, there is no such thing as a rich man. He had said this when he lost his affluent uncle, who was diagnosed twice of a curable illness in Sierra Leone. It also reminded me that no matter how I travel the world over and hold the passports of the most developed countries in the world, I am still a Sierra Leonean. Today, I'm going to talk about the current Ebola epidemic and its broader systemic challenges, particularly as it relates to corruption and how that has and we continue to impact women and children in Sierra Leone. First, I'm going to talk about how Ebola has affected women and children. Then I'm going to look at how the world and Sierra Leone responded. Then I will move on to outline some short-term recommendations. Finally, I will talk about the broader systemic failure and conclude by making long-term recommendations going forward. Even without the war and epidemics, women in Sierra Leone are faced with challenges. I became passionate about women's issue, not just because I am a woman, but as a result of my experience working with women behind bars in Sierra Leone State Prison. As a young law student working with Advocate, I met another young and beautiful woman named Mark Capri. who happened to be on death row. Ma'am Capri has spent 8 years in prison for a crime she did not commit. Ma'am Capri is one of two wives married to her husband. And sometime in 2003, Ma'am Capri's stepchild died of apparent medical poisoning. Her husband, himself a suspect, and the other wife, Lord Ma'am Capri, into accepting responsibility on the pretext that they will help exonerate her while she was behind bars. She ignorantly accepted responsibility and thumbprinted a coerced confession that she did not even understand. She had limited access to a lawyer. She was an illiterate, and she was poor. Thankfully, Ma'am Capri's case was reviewed by advocate, and she finally got a presidential pardon. But Ma'am Capri's story represents what many women in developing countries like Sierra Leone face. These women face discrimination, maltreatment, poverty, rape, neglect, disease, and abuse, among a host of other challenges. And all of these happen during or without epidemics. Now, with the Ebola, the challenges women have facing has quadrupled. As you may have seen in the news, as of today, Sierra Leone has lost 10 doctors. I mean, this is a very tragic situation for a country of a population of 6 million with fewer medical personnel. But what is even more tragic is the fact that for every one doctor that have died, several women have also died. Unfortunately, they don't make the same headlines. And in this epidemic, by the time anyone starts to show symptoms, the last person that infected person may have had contact with is a woman. Either because she is a mother, a nurse, a caregiver, or a volunteer. Before the Ebola crisis, Sierra Leone was one of the countries with the highest maternal and infant mortality rate in the world. It was one of the most dangerous places to have a baby. But the country has been making improvements in this area. However, these improvements have been reversed due to the diversion of resources to contain the Ebola epidemic. Since the outbreak, more women are giving birth at home under deplorable conditions, either because they are too afraid to go to the hospital, or healthcare workers themselves are reluctant to perform procedures that would involve too much blood and bodily fluid. Women have been particularly affected because of their traditional roles, whether as caregivers, traditional birth attendants, petty traders, healthcare workers, or the risky part they play in burials. A journalist recently contacted me to know what role women play in the burial team. At first, it sounded so ridiculous to me. But upon reflection, I was taken aback because for the first time, I realized that their role is often undocumented. Traditionally, women are the ones who wash the bodies of diseased women and children in Sierra Leone. And we now know that the corpse of an Ebola-infected person is several times contagious than when the infected person is alive. So you can imagine. The whole infection control has been currently focused on person-to-person contact. But what we have not discussed in detail is conjugal infection. We know that the WHO guideline indicates that the virus remains in the semen for 60 days after the male patient has been declared Ebola-free. But in a society where it is a taboo for a woman to deny her husband sex, husbands who have been cured from Ebola now pose a different threat of spreading it through sexual intercourse to their wives. And these wives would eventually spread it to the other members of the community. And I already know of a case in Kailangun where this had happened. Schools have now been closed for nearly 6 months. This means more children will fall out of school and fall into illiteracy, which is already currently high. My experience from the 10-year war shows that when schools are closed for such a long period, nearly half of the students never go back to school. And you know what? Girls are more likely not to return due to either teenage pregnancy or forced marriage or engaging in commercial sex. A huge percentage of orphans are missed because the Ebola response now is focused on containment rather than the devastation it is leaving in its wake. Oftentimes, with Ebola orphans, the community and surviving family members reject many of them. This is because of fear of infection, and I get it, because in October, a family support unit policewoman volunteered to adopt an Ebola orphan, and both policewoman and Ebola orphan became infected and both died. So let me briefly comment on local and international response. The response, both locally and internationally, initially was very slow. Internationally, it was seen as an isolated African disease. Locally, the epidemic was politicized. There was lack of trust between the government and the citizens about even the epidemiology of the disease. The Koroma government, for instance, only declared a state of emergency under pressure from citizens, and when Helen Johnson Sirleaf of Liberia had already done so. But today, international community has been very instrumental in trying to contain the virus. We have American soldiers, British soldiers, Cuban and French presence on the ground. Although the infection is not showing any sign of abating in Sierra Leone in particular, but we know, and I do hope, that the disease will be contained. But most of these troops and medical personnel will leave. So as laudable as these efforts are, they are not sustainable. What happens after they are long gone? They might be successful in eradicating Ebola, but what we would have done is treat the symptom and not the disease. If institutions are broken, if there are no robust healthcare infrastructures, there is probability that this vicious disease and other viruses might resurface in Sierra Leone and meet us quite unprepared. But we can do something about it. Yes, we can. We can't let the gains in maternal and infant mortality just slip away like that. We have to restructure and improve the healthcare system in Sierra Leone. By that I mean, we have to open dedicated hospitals where pregnant women and maintain the resources already allocated for that. We have to create recovery centers to house men who have been cured of Ebola for 60 days so that they cannot infect their partners. We know there are logistical issues, but this is a very legitimate concern that cannot be overlooked if and only if we want to break the cycle of infection. I mean, if people are going to schools, people are going to clubs, people are going to churches and mosques, we need to reopen schools so that children will not lag behind in education. This will reduce teenage pregnancy. I mean, children will also be in a controlled environment where the teacher can actually monitor the amount of children that comes in or who gets sick. They can actually monitor that. We can also limit the activities. For instance, we can say, okay, no assembly or no soccer playing, but at least schools have to be reopened. And we can also relieve parents who are faced with two options now. One is either to leave the children at home unsupervised or never go to work and care for their family. So we can also relieve parents of that. We should resist from using schools as holding centers. Recently, the Prince of Wales Secondary Soccer Field has been turned into an Ebola center. I mean, if we continue this trend, it's like sending a message to students that don't, please, just pack your books and burn them. Schools are not going to reopen anytime soon. So we should stop that. Orphans are vulnerable. But Ebola orphans are more vulnerable. Unlike the war, nobody is ready to adopt them. So more than ever before, we should support orphanages like the Save Our Souls Children Orphanage and others that have been doing a good job in Sierra Leone. And if these are overwhelmed, we should create new orphanages where they can care and house children. Otherwise, we're going to end up having as much street children as we can imagine. We should create specific programs targeting women in particular, with sufficient information on prevention and response. For example, we can teach them about, you know, how to follow strict burial practices. There is this famous saying that says, if you educate a man, you educate an individual. But if you educate a woman, you educate a nation. These women can actually pass on what they have learned to their families and other community members. We must support more organizations like Power Women 232, Women Rise Up Against Ebola, the Debutante Senior Forum, and a host of others that are already creating immediate impact without the unnecessary bureaucracy of government agencies. The narratives of this disease must change. It reminds me of the early days of AIDS when they say, if you touch an AIDS person, automatically you are infected. So the narrative should change. There is this song that states, if you are infected with Ebola, you die. And that is not true. I mean, we have been seeing people getting cured of the disease. So the thing is, if we don't change the narratives, sick people are going to flee when they see a healthcare worker, dressed up like somebody going to space. Also, relatives may hide their loved ones because, you know, giving up a sick one that is, you know, sick of Ebola would be like sentencing that sick one to death. So if we don't change the narratives, we might not be seeing an end to this soon. We need more media coverage. I don't see much of the Ebola news nowadays on media. Are we getting too comfortable with the disease? I ask that both local and national media keep Ebola in the news until the disease is contained. But these are just immediate actions to stop the virus. The longer systemic challenges need to be addressed, and that is corruption and accountability. With regards to healthcare, as in other sectors like education, corruption is hampering efforts to improvement. Oftentimes, enough resources are not even allocated towards health. And even if it does, much of the funds are siphoned and ends up in the pockets of gluttonous politicians. Now, let me give you a few instances of where we have been going wrong with corruption. Sierra Leone was among the fastest growing economy in the world. We've had some of the robust developments here to improve our healthcare sector. Yet we continue to be among the most corrupt countries in the world. In 2013, Sierra Leone led the whole world in a Transparency International Corruption Barometer report for paying bribes. This is an indication of a broken system that needs fixing. Even though Sierra Leone has been reinstated on the Extractive Industries Transparency Initiative, we were suspended sometime for failing to account for our mineral resources. We are also being declared ineligible for the Millennium Challenge Corporation Compact because we couldn't pass the MCC's Corruption Index. The Minister of Defense, who is also the head of the Presidential Ebola Task Force, few days ago announced removing 6,000 ghost workers. Ghost workers are workers that are non-existent. They are just there on the voucher. So the minister announced removing 6,000, not 600, these ghost workers on Ebola voucher. And what is more pitiful is that the United Nations has taken over payments of Ebola frontline healthcare workers, especially on the burial team, because of the increase in strikes over salaries. I mean, I can go on and on and on and on. So giving aid or cash donations without connections to functioning systems in Sierra Leone would not create any impact. Now, this is what we should do. The international community must reinforce its pressure against corruption in poor countries like Sierra Leone, because that will do more good than all the aid groups can achieve. Even though we have the Anti-Corruption Commission, it lacks political will, and it's just a paper plan. We've had high-profile cases with few convictions, and even if they are convicted, they ended up being exonerated on appeal. We must improve communication between government and citizens by publishing data so that citizens can follow money from sources to results and hold government accountable. My project at NED seeks to engage citizens of Sierra Leone, especially youths and the Sierra Leonean diaspora, to report on corruption and hold government accountable. It is not only about naming and shaming, but calling on perpetrators and ensuring that siphoned resources are traced and retrieved. It calls for a transparent government where citizens will be informed of what the government is actually doing. As citizens of Sierra Leone, we must ensure that corruption, which is taken for granted in our society and in a way has become a norm, must be eliminated, whether it is petty corruption or grand corruption. Our country needs fixing, and that fixing needs to take root from within. I also call on the Sierra Leonean diaspora to take an active role in the governance of Sierra Leone, because like any other Sierra Leonean, the diaspora have a stake and a voice. You are the ones that contribute most of the campaign funds when politicians are running for office. Most of you are investors that own private businesses in Sierra Leone. And you are the ones that send remittances to family and friends when Sierra Leone is faced with crises like this. I therefore challenge you to act and make our country a better place. In closing, let me emphasize why this disease is different. It is not malaria. It is not AIDS. It is not even the 10-year brutal war that Sierra Leone underwent. Ebola challenges the very fabric of our humanity. It is the disease that targets some of the best in our society. The doctors, the nurses, the mothers, pregnant women, the volunteers, the caregivers. It doesn't take away individuals. It takes away families. In Liberia, there was a woman, Diana, whose boyfriend, Emmanuel, got infected with the virus. By then, Diana was pregnant. She initially took care of Emmanuel before taking him to the hospital, where he was eventually treated. Unfortunately, by then, Diana was already infected and prematurely delivered the baby at home with the help of her mom, who is also a nurse. Two local clinics denied Diana because she was bleeding after having the baby. By the time she was taken to the third clinic, she passed away. For Diana's parents, it was a bittersweet story. It symbolizes the end of one life and the beginning of another. As any parents will do, Diana's parents saw this baby as theirs and immediately started taking care of her. Anything to keep this baby alive, and by extension, their lineage. Unfortunately, the young baby died. It too was infected. Now, what we don't know is whether the grandparents were infected too. But this tragic incident brings to light the complexities of a virus that preys on love and humanity. What Diana's parents did is what any parent would have done, regardless of where they are in the world or how educated they are. Sometime from the comfort of boardrooms, it is easy to think that if only Africans stop their primitive behavior of eating monkeys or not touching or washing dead bodies, we could have had this under control. How I wish that was true. How do you tell a mother to abandon the only child she has ever had? How do you tell a parent to let her pregnant daughter die because she may be infected? How do you handle a situation where every pregnant woman is a suspect? How? These are stories of families caring for their loved ones in the midst of tragedy. These are not African stories. These are human stories. Thank you.
Thank you, Ila, for that very passionate, sobering, and eloquent presentation. I can see why Harvard University picked you to deliver their commencement address. We will now turn over to Kamisa, who will offer some comments and some questions, and then we'll open the floor to the audience. Kamisa.
Thank you. Ila, I would like to congratulate you on your presentation, and it was extremely rich and very special. And I'm not saying that because I'm supposed to say that. I'm saying that because I think that most of us here who work on West Africa have attended a few events on Ebola over the past few months here in Washington, D.C. And very rarely I've heard personal stories of the disease. And really what you brought was the human aspect. And I know how difficult it must have been to actually present on a topic that's so close to you. As a West African woman from Sierra Leone who has family back there, I think that's that took some courage, so congratulations. So I would like to start by reminding all of us that the NED has been involved in Sierra Leone, in Liberia, and Guinea, which are the three most affected countries of the Ebola crisis. So really, Ebola has had a regional dimension that even went beyond Guinea, Sierra Leone, and Liberia. Other countries such as Mali have had a few cases, and Mali has just been declared Ebola-free, but really Guinea, Sierra Leone, and Liberia have been the three countries that have been facing this tragedy. One important thing that you brought through your presentation was that Ebola has affected countries which had already been facing serious challenges in terms of corruption, in terms of human rights, in terms of accountability. So this Ebola crisis has really added to a series of challenges that are still going on. In all of these three countries, Sierra Leone, Liberia, and Guinea, our NED grantees have continued working on these governance-related issues. In Sierra Leone and Liberia, which are the two countries I would like to focus on here, our grantees have been working on accountability issues and on the constitutional review process that have been going on in both of these countries. And really, when we went to them and asked them, well, do you want to stop implementing activities in these countries, we can be flexible. Their reaction was, well, there is an after Ebola. Ebola is really what's happening now, and it's worrying, but there will be an after Ebola, and we really need to take care of the systemic aspect and really the structure of the government and these accountability issues that will not disappear after Ebola does. I would like to maybe highlight three links that I think have been missing or have been covered very superficially around DC over the few months. So Ebola, health aspect, yes. Ebola, nasty disease, we know that. We also know that people die from Ebola. But really, what's actually complex is the link between Ebola and security. And when I mention security, I'm thinking food security, for example. I'm thinking human security. And I'm thinking national security, not of the US, but of the countries that are at play here. Also the link between Ebola and economic governance. Even though the economic impacts of Ebola have been widely covered, the question is, what have been the effects of economic mismanagement on the actual health crisis of these countries? So a sub-question to that would be, how can you expect leaders in Sierra Leone, Liberia, and Guinea to really focus on the health crisis when they actually send their loved ones to seek healthcare in London, Paris? And a third point would be the links between Ebola and political governance, which is, I think, the aspect that interests us the most here. So what I'm trying to say is that, yes, Ebola is a nasty disease which brought about a health crisis. However, Ebola also brings about the questions of security, economic, and political governance. So I would like to ask you two questions before the audience does, and I'm sure you'll get a lot of questions here. The first will be, I don't know if you all remember, but during the August U.S.-Africa summit, both Ellen Johnson Sirleaf of Liberia and Bike Roma and of Sierra Leone did not show up. They had originally accepted the invitation, and they later declined, saying that they had to deal with the Ebola crisis at home. However, President Alpha Condé of Guinea did come to Washington, D.C. So does that translate in different ways in which this crisis has been managed in Sierra Leone, Liberia, and Guinea? So have all these three countries dealt with the crisis in different ways? That's my first question. And the second question is really on the major elections that are scheduled in Sierra Leone, Liberia, and Guinea between 2015 and 2017. So the question will be, what do you think could be the effects of this epidemic on the political stability of Sierra Leone and Liberia? And I will leave Guinea out. We can talk about Guinea a little later. And to that would be, is the crisis an opportunity for leaders in these countries to show leadership? Or would it be an excuse for them to extend power and take unilateral policy measures without consulting with their relevant stakeholders?
Thank you, Camissa. So, Ila, you can perhaps address different elements in those questions as you respond. But maybe you could just say, how have the three countries handled the crisis differently? And what does that reflect about their varying styles of leadership?
Thank you very much, Camissa, for your comments and questions. With regards to how these three countries have handled the Ebola crisis, we all know that the Ebola crisis started in Guinea, but the impacts of Sierra Leone and Liberia have had more victims than Guinea. And as I speak, I think the international community or the international media is more focused on these two countries, Liberia and Sierra Leone, because as I've earlier said, they have had the most victims. For Liberia, I know, for Guinea, sorry, I know that medical personnel were killed. That has not happened in Sierra Leone and Liberia, as far as I know. These three countries share borders, and the borders are very porous. So that is one reason why the disease has such a widespread, because people from Sierra Leone, Guinea, and Liberia can easily move from country to country. So we have a very fluid border. With regards to Liberia, I think Helen Johnson Sirleaf was somehow proactive. She could, at the beginning of this outbreak, she could grant interviews to anyone who bothered to ask, whereas Ernest Bai Koroma was somehow passive. And also, Liberia took specific steps to contain this virus, and now we are seeing that in Liberia, numbers are actually going down as compared to Sierra Leone. Liberia was forced to close its border, and there was even the saying that if the border security see somebody jumps from Sierra Leone or Guinea into Liberia, that person should be shot on sight. Yes, we've heard that. So they were the ones who first closed their borders. And also, they had specific things that they did, like cremation of the body. Sierra Leone hasn't done that, either because of traditional, you know, sensitiveness or, you know, but Sierra Leone hasn't spoken anything about cremation. Also, I'm not trying to be biased here, but I think there was a massive international support in Liberia than Sierra Leone. And most people nowadays are saying that the US support or the US response was much more robust than the British response. And we are seeing that by how the figures are going down. Also, there is this thing that special Ebola units were put up in Liberia for healthcare workers. But as I speak in Sierra Leone, young doctors are on strike because they continue to die, nurses continue to die, and they don't have the special units where these doctors could be taken to care for. So I guess these are some of the things that set the two countries apart. And I'm also urging my fellow Sierra Leoneans to remain vigilant. I mean, we must ensure that quarantines are taken, you know, in good faith. And we must ensure that if people are in quarantine, we must care for them and ensure that the quarantines are kept safe. And people don't actually escape from quarantines to go into the community and infect other people. So we must be vigilant. We have seen that in Kailan and Kenama, where the virus started, that the numbers are going down. But unlike Freetown and Potloko, and recently in Konor, where so many corpses were found in a building, like 89 corpses, we've not, you know, been doing our job well. So we need to be vigilant. I'm not only talking about the government, but as citizens, we too have a role to play. We must be vigilant. So these are some of the differences with the two countries.
Thank you, Ila. We have now plenty of time for questions and comments from the audience. Would anyone like to be the one to ask the first question? Yes, the gentleman in the back. If you could introduce yourself and tell us your affiliation, please.
Hi.
Yeah, it's on.
Hi. My name is David Legg. I actually grew up in Sierra Leone. I actually went to school in Sierra Leone and went to Furabi College before I actually migrated to the States. And my question here, first of all, I'd like to thank Ms. Rogers for her presentation, which was very, very good and very rich in terms of information and in terms of the background. And I also want to congratulate you or thank you also for your recommendations and suggestions. I think they're brilliant suggestions. However, my question to you will be, what will you say to Sierra Leoneans who would think reopening of schools is premature? considering the fact that we have medical doctors dying, one of them a cousin of mine, Dr. Rogers. And I'm also aware of the fact that the Prince of Wales School, which was turned into an Ebola center, I'm an alumni of that school, I attended the Prince of Wales, and I'm concerned. But again, Sierra Leoneans will want to think, you know, we have highly trained medical personnel dying of Ebola. The numbers are going up. I mean, how safe are children back in schools? Yes, we're talking structure, but how much structure can we have in these schools? Pro-education, I think education should, you know, proceed. I agree with you, during the rebel war, the education dropped in that country, and I'm concerned, you know, about education in Sierra Leone. But what will you respond to concerned Sierra Leoneans like myself who will think reopening school may be premature at this time, considering the level of the epidemic and how it can be controlled? Thank you.
Thank you. Ila?
Yeah. Thank you very much, David, for that question, and thanks for coming. I get it. In as much as the idea of governments closing school is good, but it may have negative impact for a system that already needs as much educated people as possible. I mean, the government closed schools, but have we had any, are the numbers going down in terms of infection rates? No. Schools have been closed for quite a long time, but numbers are still rising up, despite the fact that, you know, children are staying at home. So it is better to open schools now than to face a high level of illiteracy in the long run when this Ebola epidemic is contained. That is why I'm urging government, the international community, and all other stakeholders to reopen school so that children may not lag behind. I mean, you know, if you grew up in Sierra Leone, you know that with schools closed for such a long time, children drop out of school. Most of them don't go back to school. And the reason why I am concerned is because girls are more likely not to go to school. And we've already have, you know, this disproportion between educated men and women. So if we allow our nation to lag behind in education, we are going nowhere. So that is my view. And thank you for your question.
Thank you, Ina. Yes, the other gentleman at the back and a few other hands in the... Okay.
Thank you. My name is Yaya Fanusi. I'm with the United States of Africa 2017 Project. Thank you very much for your great work you're doing, and also NED. I'm glad you mentioned the symptom. You see, in the early 60s and early 70s, when we were saying these countries in Africa are not viable, we were looked like lunatic fringe. Now, the symptom is not what we're going to have to focus on. It's the accountability that you were talking about. But to provide the resources to cure the health security of the people, Sierra Leone, Liberia, and Guinea, and many of these African countries are not viable, they don't have the resources, it is not capable. So what we need to focus on for what you might call regional tackling of such problems, security, health, and such an economic things. Otherwise, you're wasting your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Ila, would you like to respond, or Kamisa, to that, about the need for regional?
You want to comment?
Okay, thank you for your comment. It's clear that we do need to have regional and international responses to these questions and issues. Carl has a question.
Thanks, Carl Gershman-Ned. First of all, Neil, that was a marvelous presentation. And I want to congratulate you. And also, you know, you're the fellow for, I guess, a couple of more months. And, you know, to have a voice like yours in this country at this time is very important. And I just hope we find a way to make maximum use of it, because you can reach out. As I know you did, I heard this morning that you've met with those three very former officials of our government at the U.S. Institute for Peace.
Yeah.
And that leads to my question, which is, you know, what are you asking of this country specifically? What do you want us to do, both in terms of what we can do ourselves and how we can mobilize international support where, you know, where we have influence in international institutions, and I would imagine that the U.S. could be very effective. And then, you know, are you satisfied with what this country is doing, and are there areas where we could be doing better?
Thank you, Carl.
Thank you very much, Carl. I have one simple thing to say with regards about what I want the United States to do specifically. I want the United States to take the fight against Ebola into Sierra Leone, as it has been doing in Liberia. Of course, the CDC has a presence in, you know, Sierra Leone, but I want much more of that, because I don't want to see an entire nation be wiped out because of this vicious disease. That is a simple thing I want to ask the United States to do. Also, I want to ask the United States and other international communities to continue putting more pressure on countries like Sierra Leone. I mean, you guys give a lot of aid to countries like Sierra Leone, but we haven't been doing much. We have one of the most robust development aid than any other country, but look at our healthcare system. It's still in ruins. So I urge you, like you've been doing before with the Millennium Challenge Compact, wherein you give aid based on whether the country has a free market or whether it has low corruption. I insist on programs like that, that you don't just give aid because of giving aid, or that the government asks, oh, I want so and so money. You have to know where that money is going. Governments have to be more accountable to the people themselves, not just to you, but to Sierra Leoneans themselves. And Sierra Leoneans must be involved in every process. If you are to give, you know, the Sierra Leonean government X amount of money, let that be published in every Sierra Leonean newspaper, or let that be published on radio stations, so that even the man in the village will understand what this is about. That is what I want to see, not only for now in the containment of the Ebola, but in the future. Because without that, we might come here again, maybe in the next 5 or 10 years, to talk about Ebola or another disease. And what is even more frightening is that it takes only one patient or one victim to travel from these countries to the United States, as we see with the Ebola patients. So if you don't take the fight to where the source is, then there can be no impact. Thank you.
Ila, this relates to a question that I have, and I'll turn to the others in the audience, and that is to perhaps shed a little light on your own efforts as a fellow, as they relate to your project at NED, because I know that one of the things you are looking at is how the citizens of Sierra Leone could take on the fight against corruption, so going to the heart of the problem in the country. So maybe a word about your project.
Thank you very much, Jaxis. My project here is actually titled Citizens' Engagement in the Fight Against Corruption. This project is going to be citizens-led and citizens-owned. It is not going to be government-owned. In Sierra Leone, we realize that there is a problem about corruption. And of course, we've been trying to do something about it. As I mentioned earlier, we have the Anti-Corruption Commission. But this is just, you know, it's just on paper. There's no political will behind it. I mean, there have been convictions, but most of these, I don't see any high-profile person that has stolen so much resources in jail. I haven't seen it. So my project here is to allow citizens themselves to police, either it's the government, either it's
businesses, or even civil society and nonprofits, so that citizens themselves can trace whatever resources is coming in. They can trace those resources to results. Now, I know, you know, perhaps you're scared, oh, this is some witch hunting. My project is not about witch hunting. If government is ready, if the government of Sierra Leone is ready, we can actually work together so that this can serve as an incentive for them to prosecute. Because if citizens are aware of what is really going on, then government would know that, oh, everybody knows. So there is no hiding place. Also, if citizens themselves own this project, for a country where, you know, corruption is like the norm. Sometimes Sierra Leoneans don't see corruption as anything. So if citizens themselves take up this initiative and say, oh yes, we're gonna work on this, we want to make our country a better place, then we can see this going forward. Citizens are not going to be pushed by government. Citizens are not going to be pushed by the international community. That is why I said it has, our country needs fixing, and that fixing has to take root from within us. We have to come up with this initiative, and that is what my project at NED is going to talk about. I mean, it's cheap. It does not require billions of dollars. It's cheap, using simple mobile technologies to report on corruption, and I think that will be effective. So I have been having a lot of meetings with potential partners, and also I have been looking at what has really worked in other countries that would, you know, be transported to Sierra Leone. Thank you.
So the potential for digital technologies to help tackle the fight against corruption. Mm-hmm. We have a question in the front, and then right behind you, and then one on the other side of the aisle. Right behind you.
I'm Niloufar Ahmed from Millennium Challenge Corporation, and both Liberia and Sierra Leone were actually selected for the compact development. But the work right now is on hold because both the governments are so busy addressing the Ebola virus disease. We are hoping that we are going to pick up our work within 6 months. And Liberia is actually showing a lot of promises. Two issues I would like to actually pick up from your presentation, Ila. One is the whole accountability system, and I'm really happy that you'll be working on a project to establish a citizens-owned accountability system. And the other issue is stigmatization. The information from Liberia and CLU is that there is a new kind of exclusion within the countries. Before there were a lot of exclusion of the poor, certain ethnic minorities, etc. Now the survivors or caretaker of the survivors or victims have become a new excluded group. A lot of them are not allowed to work outside in the field, etc. And as you know, the economic activity is really going down. So if you are actually trying to develop an accountability system, it should start from the grassroots, particularly also not only accountability, but if you can also work reducing the stigmatization there. That would be really helpful. And all on the accountability front, I would say that rather than having a very parallel system of the citizens, the process has to include the government as well, the local government particularly, because unless you create a process, it will remain a parallel system. Your work will be very much to influence the government to have a accountability that includes both government and the citizens. So I think you should, if you initiate it from the very beginning, that would be very helpful to do it. And I think you should look at examples from India, Indonesia, where they have a very much village-based social accountability system that includes both government and the citizens. And it actually reduced corruption a whole lot, particularly at the lower level. But national and international corruption sometimes is very difficult. Thank you.
Thank you for those helpful comments. Okay, right, Marlene, right there, on right next to you, and then on the other side of the aisle.
My name is Joe Krause. Sorry about that. Oh, that's better. Yeah, I didn't think I could hear myself. Thought maybe it was just me. My question is, given to what extent does this create an opportunity, and this is slightly related to Camissa's question, both at the political level with leaders, but also you mentioned your work trying to mobilize the citizens. To what extent do citizens on the ground, does this create an opportunity to address the underlying problems, or is so much attention being focused on the immediate emergency response that that's not really sort of what's being considered? Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. I'll take a look at one.org, and because I may be interested in some of the information that you guys have on your site. The whole, you know, response is focused now on how to contain the virus, even in Sierra Leone. There's not much going on, you know, not much activities, even in terms of how to, you know, address corruption. Even in, because like recently when the head of the presidential Ebola tax force reported on, you know, 6,000 ghost workers on the Ebola voucher, I don't think that has been dealt with, because most of our focus is on how to contain the virus itself. I mean, you want to have people to govern, right? So where this vicious disease is taking away lives, one of the major concerns that the government is preoccupied with now is how to address the containment. But as citizens and the international community, I don't want us to forget that by only tackling the Ebola disease itself, it's like treating the symptom and not the disease. I mean, the disease by accountability, disease by, you know, wiping corruption out of these countries. So I guess in as much as we are talking about the containment of the disease, let's not forget the long-term impact of accountability and corruption, because that is why we are in this mess. And I always tell people, I mean, this disease would have, you know, been in any place. Let's say, for instance, in Britain or in America. But the way how you people should have handled it would have been different, because you have systems in place. And that is lacking in countries like Sierra Leone. So in as much as we are focusing on containing the virus, let us still be talking about the broader systemic issue, and that is corruption and accountability. So we have to keep pushing. We have to keep pushing. Thank you.
Thank you. We have some questions on this side of the aisle. The woman in the yellow.
Good afternoon. My name is Maria Makabia, and I am the co-founder of a magazine for teenage girls in West Africa, and our goal is to promote literacy, leadership, and empowerment. So when you were discussing some of the long-term issues and results of kids not being in school, I very much identified with what you were discussing. In terms of your recommendations, you do provide a lot of recommendations on how to tackle some of these long-term systemic issues. But my question is how you prioritize those recommendations, and also what you consider some of the low-hanging fruit in the short term to either prove to governments or other stakeholders that some of these issues are worth tackling now as opposed to later. Thank you.
Thank you. Another question?
Okay. So maybe Arthur, you could ask your question, and then we can take one more on that side. Did somebody else have his hand up first? Go ahead, yes.
Hi, Nicholas Cook at the Congressional Research Service. I'm wondering if you could give us your analysis of the motivations behind appointing Paulo Conte, the Minister of Defense, to head the Ebola Task Force, as opposed to, say, a close political associate of the president, as opposed to, say, the health minister. And second, you had mentioned the ghost worker issue and the UN taking over healthcare worker payments. Are there other specific examples of corruption or mismanagement of the epidemic by the government that you would cite? And conversely, what has the government done right? Thank you.
Thank you. And we can take Arthur's question as well.
My question, there's a right outside of that never seen famine in a democracy. So I think the same applies, I think, to pandemic. I think you addressed that particular point very well. But I think you spoke about citizens and the international community, but you didn't speak about the African region, because, you know, they're going to be meeting in January. You know, the leaders are going to be meeting in January. You know, the thinking on the continent is changing at the moment. You know, some feel that I think we should also see the best in our leaders and work with those leaders who are good, if there are any good leaders at all on the continent. But I mean, I think maybe there might be a few. And one of the issues that are going to be discussed at African Union heads of state summit in January is about the ECOSOC, which is, you know, the body within the African Union that allows, you know, citizens, you know, to engage on important issues that are affecting the nation. So is there anything that you're thinking along those lines, maybe to engage at African Union level? And also the Open Society, the South African OSISA, has a department or an officer who was working on the Africa peer review mechanism, which is a mechanism that looks at issues of accountability and corruption. So you might want, you know, to think along those lines. I don't know whether it's a question or a comment. Thank you.
Both.
It's both. So maybe you could combine your response to Mariama's and Arthur's. Mariama was asking, of all the various recommendations that you made, which might take priority over others? Are there some that are more important to tackle? Maybe some are easier to take on than others? And then are there some regional institutions that can also help, as Arthur was saying, the Africa Union meeting in January for their summit?
Thank you very much for your questions. Mariama, that name's, you know, resonates, you know, something to me. Are you from Sierra Leone?
Yes, my parents.
Oh, okay, thank you. So looking at the short term, these can be met immediately, because in as much as we want to fight corruption, we need to contain the disease itself now. So by creating, dedicated hospitals for pregnant women to go to, is very much in place now. We have to act on that. Also, creating recovery centers, you know, where men that have been cured of Ebola can be held, is also very important now, because if we want to stop the infection, we have to, you know, take these steps. And after that, I mean, we have to get the children to school. Leaving the children at home has not improved the infection rate. So if we get children in school, like I said before, we have a controlled environment where these kids are. And in fact, we can actually equip the teachers with the thermometers so that when each student comes in, they can actually take the thermometer of the students and see, you know, how the temperature reads. We can employ them in that. So if the teachers are sitting at home and government is still paying them salaries, why not get these kids to school? I think that is important too. Then we can tackle the corruption. But we don't have to forget about corruption entirely. But I think these short-term recommendations should be implemented as soon as possible to contain the virus itself. Thank you very much.
And then any regional mechanisms that might be useful?
Well, for the AU, I mean, just like the international community, they were very, 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 you know, they treated the whole thing with levity. So they haven't been proactive enough for us to see that, oh, yes, this is the African Union. This is what they should be doing. So Arthur, I don't know if you're going to attend the AU meeting or the ECOSOC. When you go back to ECOSOC, tell them that they need to take the lead. When things like this happen in Africa, they need to take the lead so that other countries, especially West Africa, cannot be isolated.
And Nicholas had a question about, do you have any comments on the appointment of the political minister as opposed to the health minister?
The health minister, initially we had a female minister of health when this disease started, but she was relieved of her duty because they said she was not acting enough. But I don't buy that, because when this started, the whole thing is, as a leader, as President Koroma is the leader, the health minister, I believe she was telling him, oh, this is a crisis, declare a state of emergency. But he failed to do that. And in fact, that was the reason that brought, you know, all kinds of rumors. People actually believed that because the disease started in the southeastern part of the country, which is the stronghold of the opposition party, SLPP, that is, it is a ploy for the Koroma government to depopulate the southeastern part of the country. So in a way, the disease was politicized. And to make up for this, he removed the lady that was the minister, replaced her with a man. And then from there, he didn't end up there. He created an Ebola, he has created different kinds of Ebola response efforts. But even with the creation of the Ebola tax response team, with the Minister of Defense as head, we haven't seen improvement. We haven't. So we need to rethink the strategies. We need to do more with the help of the international community. I don't want to forget that.
So let's take a few more questions. We have Dave Peterson in the second row, and then a woman next to Mariama in the second last row on my right, and then we'll turn to this side for the third question from Eric Robinson.
Thank you, Niela. I have, I guess it's kind of a philosophical question. There's a sort of a paradox for us, I think, especially here at NED, where we're working on promoting democracy. We've been involved, like Kamisa said, in Sierra Leone for many, many years, from before the Civil War and through that crisis. And you know, recently, we've looked at Sierra Leone and we said, oh, this is a democracy. They're doing pretty well. They don't really need us anymore at the endowment. You've had a series of good elections. There's a pretty strong civil society. You passed a freedom of information law recently, which was, you know, kind of a breakthrough. And so, the paradox is that here is, and we're seeing this in some other countries, Mali, for example, even Liberia, where these countries that look like they're pretty well-established democracies turn out to be doing a really lousy job of governing. There's all this corruption. The democracy is very shallow. I mean, what's going on? What's the problem? Is democracy really so fallible?
Thank you.
Should we take a couple more?
Okay. Oh, let me answer.
You want to answer? Go ahead. Yes. How shallow is democracy in West Africa?
Thank you very much, Dave, for that philosophical question. Indeed, it is philosophical. So I have to, you know, gather some strength to answer that. So, but I believe what actually, in a society that is that has been very corrupt, what actually is there is not democracy, as far as I'm concerned. It's kleptocracy, because nothing much is going on. Funds are being siphoned. Everybody is trying to get his or her own share of the government coffers. So what we actually have is a kleptocracy. And for democracy, human rights, and good governance to take hold in any country, we have to minimize or get rid of corruption. Otherwise, it's like a vicious circle. We will go round and round and round and come back to, you know, whether it's poverty, whether it's political instability, and so on and so forth.
So what actually has been going on is not real democracy, but kleptocracy. And it's not only about winning elections or free and fair elections. If you win elections or the elections are free and fair, but then after winning elections, like you exclude a whole portion of stakeholders or community that have a stake in the governance of the country, then that is not democracy. So I guess we need to do more. Ned need to do more. You've been doing it, but you need to do more. And I appreciate the initiative of Ned, because you're not only, you know, targeting government, you're actually working with the community, with people themselves, people that can make a difference in the community, and that effort is laudable. So thank you, Ned.
The structures of democracy, the trappings of democracy may be there, but the culture of democracy is lacking, it would seem.
Yeah.
So okay.
We have to work on it.
Hi. My name is Mariama as well.
Mariama the second.
Okay. But I'm not from Sierra Leone. I'm from Senegal. So thanks for your presentation. That was really insightful. My question is about your short-term recommendations. So you mentioned, you know, opening up hospitals and orphanages, but I feel like these solutions would require a lot of resources. And so the question is, how can we mobilize those resources while bypassing the wider issue, which is corruption and the lack of accountability, while, you know, avoiding that they build, you know, ghost hospitals or like something like that, because there's no accountability.
So where will the money come from, in other words,
right,
to
yeah,
or where will it go even if it comes?
Exactly, yeah.
Okay, and then Eric Robinson has a question, which, yeah.
Eric Robinson, NED Africa Program. I guess I want to tie a couple of things together here for you, Yella, and ask you and maybe challenge you a little bit. I think first, I don't think it's Arthur that's going to be the one that's going to the African Union to press this case. It has to be civil society writ large, and particularly if it's your issue. As negative as we feel about some of the institutions in your own country or at the continental level, you have to engage somewhere. So,
yeah,
you know, how can you get your voice there to hear it? And sort of on, you know, of course, we at NED can do more, but when we do more, that means you do more, because we support people like yourselves and many others to do this work. So to leverage your work, what can you do in terms of getting the international community to be more accountable through your own coordination, through relationships with regional entities that focus on transparency and accountability, and also like the young woman, one of the Mariamas in the room, mm-hmm, who's a budding journalist. What role does the media and perhaps strong investigative reporting play in reducing corruption on the continent? Because the longer I've worked in and on Africa, I believe that is the single most important cross-cutting issue on the continent.
So a broad-ranging question from Eric.
I know.
Thank you, Eric.
So, okay.
So yes, Mariama too asked a question about the funding of the hospitals and where would that come from, and don't you worry it may end up in the wrong hands.
I mean, we are having a lot of international support now from the international community, and also I was talking about monies that have already been allocated by the Sierra Leone government for healthcare, particularly for maternal and infant mortality rate. But because of this Ebola, much of these resources have been, diverse to fighting the epidemic itself. But if we don't have healthcare structures in place now, whether it is funded by us or the international community, then we are going back to square one after all this is over. So we need these structures to be put up. And we have to talk about, you know, accountability and transparency at the same time. That is why I am advocating that we don't just forget about accountability and tackle the disease itself. Yes, for now, for a short term, we need to tackle the disease. We need to contain this disease. Because like I said before, if you allow this disease to consume the whole nation, who are you going to rule? So, in as much as we are building these hospitals, we are building the healthcare infrastructure, we must not forget about accountability and transparency. So I don't know if that answers your question, but thank you.
And Kamisa maybe would like to say a word in response to Eric's broad-ranging question.
Yes, so Eric, I think, intended to challenge Ila. So I'll start saying something and maybe you can
continue.
Exactly. Okay. So about the role of the media, I think that there are two levels here, especially on this Ebola crisis. You have the macro level, when we talk about accountability and the corruption issues. I think the media, international and especially local, really need to, well, have the opportunity to act as watchdogs here. The media that has come, or that the articles that have been published, for example, on the Ebola crisis, have really focused on who has died, the number of people who have died, and where they have died. Really, the resources that have gone to these countries is something that I haven't seen much. So I think that that's one important aspect. Also, the efforts of the grassroots communities have not been widely covered either. Mm-hmm. In Sierra Leone and even in Liberia, I think that grassroots communities have really taken ownership of this crisis, even more than the governments themselves. Mm-hmm. And this is also something that has been missing. So I think that it's not that we need more coverage on Ebola. I think that we've already receiving a lot of information, but this information needs to be more targeted towards what the governments have been receiving and what the grassroots communities have been doing in terms of helping the government do its job, basically.
Thank you, Vanessa. Do you have anything to add?
Somebody spoke about the Freedom of Information Act that Sierra Leone recently passed. I don't know who
Dave,
that was.
Dave had said.
You're talking about the media. That just popped into my mind. We have that. We have signed it. And I guess you guys were very instrumental in seeing that, the government passed that law. But we have this 1965 libel law still in our law that is holding people down, especially the media. Because if you say something about government and the government doesn't like it, there is every possibility that they're going to say, oh, that's seditious libel and we're coming after you. And it carries 3 to 7 years imprisonment. So that law has to be tackled also, in as much as we have the Freedom of Information Act. That law has to be tackled and continue putting pressure on the Sierra Leonean governments. We have the Freedom of Information, yes, but how much information are you putting out there for citizens to read? Most of the citizens are illiterate. If you're just writing a paper and keeping it in offices, then it's not going to reach down to the villagers. So until you create a program where, the last man, and I always say the last man in the village, can hear and actually understand what this is about, then we can create an impact by that.
Okay, we are out of time. Unless anybody has a burning question, we are going to wrap up now, and I would invite you to continue the conversation with Ila after the presentation is over. I want to thank Kamisa for her excellent comments. I want to thank all of you for coming, and I want to especially commend a woman of extraordinary courage for sharing her 5 months with us. We wish you very well. I know that you have been spending some time outside Sierra Leone, based in South Africa and here in the US, but I very much hope that you are able at some point to return to Sierra Leone because your country needs you, your region, your continent needs you.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.